The cage clanged shut, then fell, 70 foot per second. They called it the initiation drop. The pressure hurt Ira's ears. Some of the boys around him had nosebleeds too. The others laughed at the new boys. The cage stopped with a jerk a mile down in the bowels of the earth. It was pitch black, and the air, if you could call it air, was thick with coal dust. The doors opened and then began the long, stumbling walk to the tunnels. Ira crawled along the tunnel, his heart pumping so hard he thought it would burst. It was so claustrophobic. It was cold, it was wet, and it was noisy. This was where he spent his shift. It's 1943. At 19, and only weeks earlier, Ira got his call-up papers. But they didn't want him in the Army, or the Navy, or the Air Force. They wanted him down the mines. During World War II, thousands of miners joined up to fight for Queen and country. By 1943, the mining industry was left with a depleted and aging workforce. The Minister of Labour and National Service, Ernest Bevin, came up with a plan after a voluntary scheme resulted in only 1,100 new miners. So instead, each month, two numbers were pulled out of a hat, and those young men whose national insurance numbers ended in one of those numbers were chosen not to take up arms, but to take up picks and shovels. These were the 48,000 or so 18 to 24-year-old Bevin boys who kept the coal industry going during the war. There was no choice. Ira had his medical examination. He was given his travel warrant and instructions and reported to the mining training centre. He was now a Bevin boy and about to start 6 weeks' training. There were lectures and physical training and at the coalface learning to cope underground. He was issued with a helmet with a heavy miner's safety lamp, steel-capped boots, a snap tin for his sandwiches and a water bottle. A Davy lamp with a naked flame was used to detect gas. The only distinction between those who were miners by choice and those, like Ira, who were conscripted to the mines was that the Bevin boys wore overalls. The other miners wore their own clothes. The work was tough and dangerous, with more than one serious accident for every four people in the mines each year. Ira was constantly on alert for creaks and groans which were out of the norm. The tunnels were under pressure from above and below. Everyone would have been on the lookout for small stones falling from cracks or rivulets of dust which might forewarn an imminent collapse. It was tough down the pit for the Bevin boys, but it was just as tough above, where they continued to fight a different battle. Ordinary people around them didn't know or understand the Bevin boys didn't have a choice. Why hadn't they volunteered to fight? There were cowards trying to dodge the draft, some receiving white feathers for cowardice. Many bore the physical scars from their service down the pits. I often traced the blue scars on my father's wrists with my tiny fingers as a young girl. But worse was often the feeling of guilt that they had not joined their brothers, their friends, their townsmen in the forces. My father, like many, spoke little of his time as a Bevin boy. They were not honoured at the end of the war. There was no support. There were no jobs held open for them. There were no celebrations on their return home except for their loved ones. The Bevin boys were the underground army, the forgotten army. It was 50 years before they were recognised in a speech by Her Royal Highness Queen Elizabeth, and for the first time were allowed to march past the cenotaph on Remembrance Day in 1998. At last, in 2008, the many Bevin boys were awarded their very own badge of honour, but because most of the records were destroyed in 1950, there was no list to award its members, so an appeal was made for them to come forward. I knew my wonderfully modest father wouldn't raise his own hand and be counted. Perhaps those mental scars were too strong, but he did deserve the badge. Over a period of a few weeks, we asked him to tell us stories of when he was young and down the mines. We managed to get all the information we needed to help prove he served and raise our hand for him. When the honour arrived in the post, you should have seen his eyes. He wasn't a tall man, but that day he stood tall and proud. On the 7th of May 2013, the Countess of Wessex unveiled the official memorial to the Bevin boys at the National Arboretum Centre in Staffordshire, UK, in recognition for their valuable part in the war effort. 9 days before Dad's 89th birthday. Dad would have been there, but he couldn't make it. Dad passed away about 2 months before, but I know he would have stood in the sunshine at that memorial, wearing his badge with pride. This is my homage to my father and the Bevin Boys, no longer the Forgotten Army.